Kia ora everybody, Sophie Hoskins here with Jane Townsend, who is currently at Nayland College in Nelson. And she has kindly agreed to have a kōrero with us today and share her journey with different haerenga and I guess how that has progressed over the years. And yeah, super lucky she's here and willing to share her amazing knowledge and wisdom. So I'll let her introduce herself as well and crack into it. Thank you, Jane.
Kia ora, everybody. So as Sophie said, I'm Jane Townsend. I've been at Nayland College for the last 5 years. Prior to that, I was at Maunganui College for quite a number of years, actually, and was head of PE and Outdoor Ed. And through Mount Maunganui College, met Mike Brown and was involved in a research project around the place responsive approach. And so I made some big changes to the senior outdoor education programs and introduced the haerenga concept. So originally it was called a hikoi, and it was based on what Mike Brown was doing. So Oraki bound, also what he was doing with his university students. But it was a journey that started and finished at school. And part of that journey was via self-propelled transport. So kayaking, mountain biking, and trekking as a group, learning about local significant places. And so the students, it was very much co-constructed and power shared with the students. And so they would say what they're interested in, what questions they had about the place, and they would present at significant places. So if they wanted to know how a place got its name or what happens here, so it might have been a par site, or it could have been somewhere where there was a significant battle, then they would present on that. A lot of the local stories, and included a noho marae as well. And the wonderful thing about that was when the students were at the pōwhiri at the marae, they saw a lot of the stories that they had shared on the murals and in the carvings, and just to hear from the kaumātua how special it was to actually learn about the history and place in our times and our place rather than history and stories from other places and times. So, and it was a great way to model the, if you've done relationship-based learning or te ko tahitanga, the RBL approach in terms of the students being able to lead the learning of others. Also was really good in terms of their assessment at level two, assess the achievement standard 2.8. And at level three, who they actually came up with the whole concept of a haerenga in a slightly different area, so not from school. And they had proposals, and as a class, they decide where they're going to go to meet the individual and 10 goals. So that haerenga was assessed through 3.7 and 3.9. And probably the most special one was Lake Tarawera, where they heard the stories, they looked at what happened to the pink and white terraces, and just all the rich history that the area has. And then as part of that, the feedback from the students was, well, I wish that I had pronounced the Māori place names better in my presentation. So started to include the Māori tourism standards, and since that time, also the tikanga Māori standards. So that brings me to Nayland, where I'm not, I've taught the Learning Centre Outdoor Education, not teaching senior outdoor education, but I'm running the Māori Student Leadership Program. And so I've been able to take the learnings from the senior outdoor ed into this space, which has been incredible. And I know we'll talk about it later, but it's really important you just don't chuck the students in there. It's around scaffolding and those progressions. So the first camp with this group, I came across this man Callum, who's got a lot of knowledge of the local area, and he's a waka steerer. And so we had a haerenga in the Abel Tasman, The students got to learn the iwi history. So Callum has met with kaumātua from, we're in an interesting situation where we've got 8 iwi at the top of the south, so Tito Ihu, and he's met with a lot of the kaumātua and he's got a lot of the stories. So he shared the stories, we recorded them, and he also had a lot of knowledge around traditional Māori music. So playing the pūtaratara in the caves was amazing. He also had a lot of knowledge around rongo Māori, which also fueled our students to want to know more.
Yeah.
And then from there, the next one, the students gradually took over. And then they identified younger students in the school that they wanted to have a succession plan. So we took the younger students on a local haerenga from the marina, the Haven, and over to Holeshore Island and the different islands in Tahananui Beach. And our students led the learning for the younger students. So it was very much a tuakana taina situation.
Yeah.
And from there, they just became more and more confident in their knowledge. When we had a new staff induction, we, myself and the Māori student leaders took the new staff out on a waka and went through the journey. So
wow.
a different student would tell a story or a history or the geology of the boulder bank. And it was really, really powerful. So yeah, I'm a firm believer in exploring place and connecting with place. And it was a great way to do it in terms of our new staff, to see them bond together, to connect with each other and connect to place was a really great way to start the year.
Yeah.
And in terms of the student leaders as well, they are a really close-knit group and they build each other up and they empower each other. And they've even led learning for a kahuiako teacher only day.
Mm-hmm.
So they ran a rongo session in the Marsden Valley and talked about the history of the area, and they got to teach their primary school or even their early childhood teachers. So
wow.
Yeah, so
it's really cool.
Yeah it's fantastic.
So do you have any advice for those wanting to incorporate that mātauranga Māori into their own journeys or haerenga around kind of, you know, for people that might want to do that but are unsure where to begin?
Yeah, I think it's really a good idea to make links with mana whenua if you can. It could be a student's parents or grandparents, or it could be someone who's working in the education space. So most iwi have somebody working in the education space that the school can contact, and which has been quite important in terms of the versions of the stories. So yeah. All the stories that we share, we run by the iwi, so the mana whenua of the school, because particularly in the top of the south, there are different versions for different iwi. So recommend that. But I do think it's really important that you don't let barriers get in the way. So a lot of people say, oh, I don't know the local stories, or I'm not sure. Like the students know so much.
Yeah.
And they know so much in their connections and they can teach us. I've never been on a haerenga where I haven't learned something new.
Yeah.
So being able to let the students take the lead is really important. At Mount Maunganui College, like the head of Māori was really into the place responsive approach in the haerenga, so he really was keen to come on camps, and it was really great to work with him, and he had a lot of strengths to bring as well. So if you have someone on staff to support and who's passionate about it, I think that's really important as well. And then, like, more and more so, we are, like, our school, every hui that we have, we start with karakia, we finish with karakia, that our staff are really keen to upskill in te reo Māori and tikanga. So this is bringing that into the the outdoor space.
Yeah.
And it's such a fantastic opportunity. And using what would normally occur in a place like when we went to Lake Tarawera when I was at Mount Maunganui College, we had a thermal hangi and we went through all the tikanga of a hangi, but because that's what was an obvious thing to do in that place.
And I guess also exploring and finding out or finding the right people that can help you with that tikanga around some of the practical skills, because it can be quite easy to just go and do the practical skills, but knowing the tikanga around it and making sure that that is, you know, more important, the learning around that than the actual skill, I think is also really important.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's all got to be in context. And even things like we had a haerenga French pass, Te Omuti, which is French pass, and one of the kuia decided to come along. I wasn't expecting her, but it was fabulous to have her. And the students asked her a lot of questions and just make sure that we were respectful and doing things correctly. I think, and I talked about Callum earlier, who's got so much expertise, and he taught the students taiha, but they were using their hoi, but using it following tikanga. So yeah, things like that. I think it's really important that that goes along with the teaching and learning program.
Yeah.
And it's, yeah, integral part, not, you can't really separate the two.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you. My next question is around just kind of some top tips for those wanting to start on this journey, or, you know, like to incorporate a journey or a haerenga into their program. Where do we start? What would you recommend if we kind of, you know, have a blank canvas?
I think definitely starting with those questions. So I think it's really important to start with a place and culture responsive approach. So, you know, those questions like what is here in this place, those natural curiosity that we all have, but especially in our young people, and what will this place permit us to do? How is this place connected with my own place? So in schools, we have a lot of students that are transient or away from their home place, and I've experienced that being here at Nayland, but I've really enjoyed the stories that connect Bad Plenty to Te Tuhu, which has been really positive. And then what can we learn here? And often it's like with the students talking about different local places and then just them coming up with the questions and then saying what they want to research further, and that can be the starting point. And then instead of assessment driving the program, then looking at the assessments, the NCA tasks or whatever standards you're going to use, and so what's going to actually work with us, so what's going to actually reward our students for their competence. And that's been a really positive thing about the Māori tourism and the tikanga standards. And things like a real positive thing about the present achievement standards is things like they set their own personal goals and their group goals, and so they can come up with a design of a haerenga that's going to meet those goals. And so they can't just say oh ski trip, you know, we'll just do the old ski trip. They have to be able to justify how that experience is going to meet their goals. And when students say, oh, it's really important for us to be present in this place and be able to, and often they say they want to connect with each other, connect with the place. They can't do that if they've got the earphones in or they're looking through their phone the whole time. So they come up with their own kawa for the haerenga to meet those goals.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think definitely starting with the student curiosity, starting with your places, and even urban places have got stories around them. And then letting it build from there. So it's a fantastic way to co-construct with students. and with our colleagues as well.
Yeah. Would you recommend, I guess, co-constructing every year? Or do you, you know, if you're starting, do you co-construct that first year and then kind of build on the same thing the following year, in terms of, you know, if you planned an actual haerenga from school to a marae, to another marae and back down a river back to school, and that was one group, would you then get the next year to do what they want to do, or do you build on, you know?
Yeah, definitely. So in the two examples I've talked about, with the level two program, it was the first camp that they went on was surfing and kayaking.
Yeah.
And it was led by myself. And so I told the stories. So I modeled the approach.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had two haerenga that they organized. And so how much guidance I gave was quite a lot more at level two, mm-hmm, than level three. So at level three, in groups, they came up with proposals and they did presentations to the class of where they should go and what they should do and the stories related to the place in order to meet their individual and team goals. And so, it all just developed naturally,
yeah,
and organically. So, yeah, level three, they had a lot more autonomy. Level two, I gave them a lot of help and links with the research and things like that. And things like, and it just can be asking the questions like, one of our camps was in the Kaimais, which was, mm-hmm, fantastic as well. But the original plan, because they had researched all the places that they wanted to go to, was going to be like a 25K walk each day.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, okay, is that going to mean you're going to meet your goals? We're going to be walking all day, probably into the night as well. And explaining, you know, that it's quite different than walking on a flat trail or whatever. And then they're, yeah, like, oh yeah, okay. And then so we'd co-construct and decide how we'd change it. But I think definitely having those progressions, and that's what I did with our leadership program as well, that started off with a lot of support and guidance and learning. And then as they gain more confidence, and it's even things like I made mashed potatoes and I organised the food for the first camp, and they're like, nah, we'll take over that. The mashed potatoes was slop. And so, you know, they took over and they actually said they decided we would go for the next one and why. And cool. And that was just fantastic. And then also seeing the first year, the students would ask me for the history and stories and things like that of places. And then by the second year, they were going to each other and they had their own expertise and they had their own connections that they used.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what I'd want. So
Yeah,
definitely making sure it's supported, and making sure that it's scaffolded.
Yeah.
Be really valuable.
Yeah, awesome. Great. And do you have anything else you want to add or put in there before we finish up?
I thought if this works, I could just share my screen. So this is a picture, a series of pictures from the haerenga. So the boulder bank, the historical lighthouse, where they talked about the geology, the history. There's been a number of par sites there and gardens, and was also used for gathering kai moana because you've got water both sides, the ocean one side, and the waka that we went out in. And the top left is one of the students running a session on rongo Māori for the new leaders.
Awesome.
So I did want to share the student voice around this. So I'm sure everyone can read that, but just we looked at how this haerenga experience is going to increase student wellbeing And you can see there that there was in all aspects, you might have to re-record this.
No, all good. You want
me to record it?
No, it's all good.
You get it out or no? Yeah. Okay. But how an experience like this really facilitates Hawora and increasing all aspects of Hawora. So in terms of how they link with each other, going home and having conversations with their parents, their grandparents, their wider whānau, being fit enough to enjoy the experience and make the most of it. Like if you are just looking at your feet, you're not going to really experience it. And that's come through from a lot of the students through Outdoor Ed and the students I work with here, that if they're fit enough that they can really enjoy the experience. And then just the history, and you look at places with new eyes when you know the stories and history behind it. And one thing I've noticed in Nelson is there's a lot of information about the colonial history of the area, but not so much about the iwi history. And it's been fantastic to learn that aspect of it. And so students have said things like, we would like to talk to the water taxi companies and have a script for them, or record a script for them, so that they're actually telling the local stories, because this area is very, very rich in history and significant stories. And probably one that had a lot of impact on our students was actually Devil Island or Rangitoto Ki Te Tonga, where there's a story about a taniwha and how it came as a big wave and destroyed a whole pā. And geologists have been there since, and they found archaeological evidence. And there was a tidal wave, there was a tsunami that destroyed a pā at the same time as the actual stories have set it. And things like Pelorus Jack and the history of the dolphins as a guardian or taniwha, and so just those really significant stories, which, you know, these students say everybody should get the opportunity to learn.
And so empowering for them to learn that and be able to have that knowledge to share with other people as well.
And that's the power of stories, and that they in a haerenga gives students the opportunity not only to learn stories, share stories, lead the learning of others, but also weave their own experiences and stories into a place, which is really special. And like you say, they take their family, take their friends to these places, then that's going to benefit more and more people in the community.
Yeah, wow, that's amazing. And so this has been with the student leaders, is that?
Yeah, so this is from the Nayland student leaders.
And that's really cool. So you have set time to kind of take them out on these haerenga as well?
Not really set time, but I find time.
Yeah, such an amazing way to build leadership capacity as well, and kind of really, you know, give them the skills to be able to stand tall and stand proud. And
exactly. And to be able to, like, a lot of our staff and community might not know the skills and knowledge that our students have, and it gives them opportunity to actually go, I can be really proud of what I know and what I can share. So
awesome. Oh, thank you so much for sharing all that with us, Jane. And Jane has also shared a couple of resources with me around the 4 signposts for place responsive teaching, I think, was it the article?
Yeah, place responsive approaches. Yeah.
So I'll put a link to that with this video and a couple of other things. But thanks again for your time. I'll stop.
No worries.
Yeah.